Today starts our new series, Joyful. We have a lot to be joyful about, don't we? We don't have to be a prisoner. We can be set free. The Word of God can set us free. And I want to just again welcome everybody to New Hope. Today's our family first service, the first of each month. We're doing a family first service where we have our kids with us. And I think it's good for not only just families to be together, not just, you know, the nuclear family as far as kids and mom and dad, but all of us is a church family. It's good to have kids around. And as we get into God's Word today, we're going to see that even when, you know, God was moving, the kids were there. God can move when kids are around, and God wants to bless us and bless our kids as well. So I'm excited about that. So I hope we'll again welcome our kids into our family communion. It's going to be a communion service as well. We're going to have communion in a little while and just celebrate what God has done for us. And just hopefully he's going to spark some joy in us. So as I was praying for this next series, you know, I really want to get the heart of the Lord as far as where he's leading us as a church and be right where he, you know, right where his spirit is wants us to be. And I really felt that this, man, we just needed a good shot of joy here at New Hope Bible Church. Anybody here need a good shot of joy? I know I do. You know, life can just beat you, can't it? It can just beat you down, man. I'm telling you, it's like, man, that just, you lose your joy. But you know what? If you have Christ, you have the Holy Spirit living in you, you have joy in you, right? You do. It's a fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, meekness, you know. So we have joy in us, and sometimes it's hard to get that joy out. But what I want to first of all distinguish in this particular series is the difference between happiness and joy, all right? Happiness is based on what circumstances, you know, it's an emotion type thing. And sometimes we can run on happiness. You know, I'm happy, this is, life is great, and all of a sudden something slams us, and all of a sudden we're not happy anymore, right? It's like, man, things were going so well, and all of a sudden, bam, it's like, man, I'm not happy anymore. Anybody ever been there before? I mean, things are just going wonderfully, and then bam, it's just like, oh, man, it's all over. Well, see, happiness can be taken away like that. It's based on circumstances. But joy, nobody can steal your joy, not unless you let them. Joy is inside of us. It comes from inside of us. And I have a little demonstration here. Is a little bottle of water. This is our little guy here too. But, you know, when you shake it up, basically, when I shake this thing up, what's going to happen? All right? What will happen if I shake this thing up? Obviously, it's going to get a little messy, isn't it? I'll go over here by Maddie here because Maddie's... and I just open this thing up. You know, it's like, oh my God, what's going to happen? So, but it's going to, obviously it's going to overflow and it's going to be pretty messy, right? It is, right? Well, same thing with joy. Sometimes when joy is shaken up within us, I'm going to put this right here, actually. When we are shaken up, joy should come out, right? It's not what happened, I always like to say, it's not what happens to us, it's what happens in us, right? It's what comes out. Now, when you're squeezed, all right, in life, what's coming out? You're like, oh my gosh, where'd that come from? Or, you know, yeah. Sometimes when we get squeezed, things come out, all right? And hopefully joy will come out. So we're going to take a look at a portion of Scripture, Nehemiah chapter 8, if you have your Bibles. And it's interesting because Nehemiah was called by God. He was a cupbearer to the king. He had, life was good for good old Nehemiah, you know. He was a cupbearer, so he, like, just took care of the king and probably got to eat a lot of good food himself. And one day, God just laid it upon his heart, what's going on in Jerusalem? You know, he had a love for Jerusalem, and he asked somebody, what's going on in Jerusalem? And they said, well, it's a mess. The walls are down. The walls are, I mean, it's just tore apart. Well, Nehemiah just got really upset. He said, oh my gosh, he loved Jerusalem, he loved God's people, and he, man, it's terrible. So God put it on his heart to build the walls, to go back and build the walls. Back then, a city already had always had walls around it because there's always enemies around, so they would build a big wall around it, and that'd protect the city, that'd close the walls at night, that type of thing too, and be kept safe in that city. Well, the walls were down, the city was a disaster, and he just felt so horrible. So he went to his king, risked his life going to the king, to ask him, hey, you know, can I go back and help rebuild the walls, you know? And God gave him great favor. So Nehemiah went to Jerusalem, and he surveyed the damage and all that too, and God just gave him a plan. I just love Nehemiah because it's a great leadership lesson on how Nehemiah came in, the vision that God had given him, and they rebuilt that wall. I think it was like 40 days, if I'm not mistaken. I think it was 40 days. Is that right, Randy? Was it 40 days? maybe it was 50 days. Yeah, maybe it was a miraculous time because those walls were very, very wide, very, very tall. They rebuilt them, put the gates back in and everything. And it was a miraculous type thing. And what I love about Nehemiah is the first thing he did when he got those walls built around Jerusalem is he said, okay, you know what we need to do? We need to get out the word of God. So that's what Nehemiah did. He said, Ezra, who was the priest, said, Ezra, grab the word of God and we want you to read it to the people. So Ezra, in chapter 8 of Nehemiah, he gets up and he starts, first of all, the people assemble. They call the people together. We are going to get into the word of God. Here, come. Now, at this time, the word of God has not been exposed to any of these people for like 70 years. The only thing they knew about the word of God is what they heard from their forefathers. The word of God was just, it wasn't anywhere. So Ezra gets the word of God. Nehemiah says, get the book and let's read. So he goes out there and it says they called the people together and they assembled, the people assembled with one purpose. I love that. They came together, man. What does it mean by they came together with one purpose? They had a purpose for being there. Their hearts were open. They knew the word of God. They haven't heard about it. They heard about it, but they haven't had it read to them. They came anticipating. They were unified. They had a purpose and they were unified. So they brought out the book of the law of Moses, and that's the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch they call it, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, five books of the Bible. So they, Ezra brought it out, and it says that he got, well, first of all, it says that he, you know, all the people assembled. Ezra the priest brought the book of the law before them, and it says in verse 2 that all the men, women, and children that could understand were there. So everybody who was with understanding, even young people, even kids, were there at this time with mom and dad, ready and anticipating what the word of God was going to say to their hearts. So they came together unified in that purpose, and I think that's amazing. So when Ezra, well, first of all, Ezra was on a high wooden platform. They built a special, and they were getting ready for this. This was a big deal. They built their house. Now they're going to build God's house, so to speak, spiritually. They got a big platform, and they built a big platform. So Ezra gets up on the platform, all right, and he's up on the platform and elevated the people, and they all of a sudden, they got excited. The Bible says in verse 3, I believe it is they, let me find that, they all rose to their feet. He went up there and he opened the Bible, he opened the book, he opened the Bible, and everybody stood up. They honored the word of God. They stood up and said, wow, that's the book. That's what we've been hearing about. Now we get to hear it. So he's up on that wooden platform. He opens the book and people are going, man, oh, wow. Okay, they rose to their feet. And then Ezra started praising the Lord, all right, and telling people how great God was. And everybody was saying, amen, amen, yelling amen. How many know you can say amen in church? You know that? I like a few amens here and there, okay? That means you guys are like reflecting a little bit, and I get energized by that. So you can throw a couple amens in there, okay? That means you're getting it, you're hearing. Well, these people got it. They were saying, amen, amen, all right, this is awesome. And then it says they bowed down and worshiped the Lord, their faces to the ground. He opened that book. Amen, amen. And then that old book opened on their faces before God. That was the effect it had on them. Don't you wish the Bible had that kind of effect on you when we opened it here at church? I pray for that. God, I want this. I want to value this book. This is the word of God. This is the word coming from you. It was inspired by you. The word of God is going to last forever and ever. It's never going to pass away. The word of God is going to last forever. So they bow down with their faces to the ground. And then on the side, both sides of Ezra, were men, Levites that would actually, as he read the word of God, these Levites, these guys who knew the word of God, would go and explain it to everybody so they understood what they were hearing. They wanted people to understand and have an understanding. I mean, kids were there, they wanted kids to understand as well. So the Levites, these people, these guys that were sitting up with Ezra would go down and maybe small group ministry, I guess it was, and get some people around and they would just explain what they had just heard, that what Ezra had just read. So everybody understood it. So it was powerful. So they would interpret the word to them. You know what happened then? They started weeping. They were mourning and they were weeping. It touched them so deeply. The word of God is powerful. So we see a pattern here, and I want to share that pattern with you. What happened back in the day of Nehemiah. And as they read the book, like I said, it just had a profound effect. A profound effect. And the Bible says that all Scripture is given, okay? And it's inspired, and it can be useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training, and for righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Bible is an instruction book to help us to know how to serve and how to love and how to obey God. And that's what they were getting back in Nehemiah's day. Now they finally knew what they had to do. They heard it from mom and dad or grandma and grandpa, but now they heard the word of God for themselves, and they now knew what to do, and it really touched their hearts. So let's look at that process. I got down to like a three-step process. Is number one was the illumination of the word of God. They opened that word, and the people just reacted right away. They were there for a unified purpose, and it just touched them. They were excited. They wanted to hear the word of God. They had a heart of expectation. They were not only willing to hear the word of God, but they were willing to obey the word of God. How many know that you can just come to church and you can hear the word of God and leave just not changed? And yeah, that was all right. It was a pretty good sermon. Yeah, it was probably about a 3 out of 10, you know, or whatever. It was all right. You know, sometimes we do that, but you know what we got to do is we got to start applying that word of God. That's where the power comes, and we apply that word. And when the Israelites came and heard the word of God from Ezra, man, they were ready to apply that word. They were excited, man, this is awesome. I want to apply that word. So it was illuminated to them as it was explained to them, and it really became real to them. And the Bible says it's that they lifted their hands first. Wow. Then they bowed down, faces to the ground. It was illuminated. It was like, wow, amazing. They now understood it. And that's what the Bible is. The Bible is like a mirror, isn't it? Boys and girls especially, you look in the mirror. You look in the mirror. Kylie, do you look in the mirror in the morning? You probably don't. I mean, you're just beautiful anytime. You don't need a mirror, right? But anyways, it's like I get in the mirror in the morning. I look in the mirror and it's like, oh, Scott, you better go back to bed. You look, oh my God, look, bags under your eyes. I mean, oh my gosh, you know, I can't wear makeup. I'm not a girl, but man, I need some makeup, you know. But, you know, when we look in the mirror, like it reveals the real us, right? And sometimes it's not pretty. But you know, the word of God is the same way. When we get in the Word of God and God inspires His Word to us and we start seeing some things in there, like maybe we're not obeying the Word or some things that will touch us, it's like a mirror. It shows us. Even in our ugliness, it'll show us. And that's what it showed to the Israelites. They knew how far they had fallen. But the Bible shows our flaws. Aren't you glad? That's why it's so important to read the Word of God, right? Because if we don't read the Word of God and know the Word of God, we don't know how to obey God and do what God wants us to do. So it illuminated the Word to them. It illuminated in their hearts. They saw the sin in their lives. This is what I love right here. They not only heard the Word, but something started to happen in their hearts and lives. It brought conviction. Illumination then brought conviction, and then it brought repentance. How many know you can be convicted of sin, yet do nothing about it? See, when we're convicted of sin, and God says, you know, and lays it on our heart that, oh my gosh, you know, I'm sorry, God, you know, I point. Man, we need to repent of that, don't we? We need to be sorry, but we also need to repent and turn away from that. Well, that's what they did. And their hearts were just cut to the core. Because they saw the errors of their way. The Bible exposed that mirror just reflected on them as far as where they were at spiritually, and they were a mess, and they knew it. And that's what the Word of God does. It's like it's living and active in Hebrews 4:12. It's sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. It gets right to where we are living, doesn't it? We can fool ourselves even, we can fool others, but we can't fool the Word of God. It just elevates and mirrors where we're at, and it penetrates our heart, and that's what it did to the people back then. So they wept, the Bible says in verse 9 of 8, Nehemiah, they wept. They felt so horrible that they just started weeping. They realized that they were out of the will of God and they were sinning against God. They were being disobedient. The sin was revealed to them and it touched them and it just cut their hearts. And they wept in sorrow. Anybody ever weep in sorrow before? Yeah, sometimes we don't really weep in sorrow like we probably should, you know? But they wept. They were just cut to the core. So again, conviction came, but they were affected so deeply that repentance came. That's the cool thing about that, is they repented. They were just crying. They just couldn't get themselves back together. And they just wanted to be right with God. So they repented, made themselves right with God. And they went on and on. But it brought back them to God. They sincerely confessed, I believe, their sin, and it brings them back. And that's what we do. If we can sincerely confess our sin, it brings us back into right relationship with God. We don't want to be out of relationship with God. We want to be in relationship with Him, because that's when we can hear His voice. That's when we can walk out His word with joy. Is when we know His word and we stay in His word and we stay in a state of repentance, as far as asking God to forgive us. So we have a right, our hearts are right for Him, right with Him. And I just love that one verse. As far as when we repent and we say, God, please forgive me, man, I just don't want to do that again. The Bible says, man, He just takes that away. And from the east to the west, man, He just takes it away. The east never meets the west. I mean, it's gone forever. We don't have to worry about the sin. We don't have to walk in guilt and sorrow. And sometimes we do that. We say, God, please forgive me. And we do repent. We don't do that anymore, but we still have that guilt feeling. Anybody been there before? That's a horrible sin. God will never forgive me for that. But you know, He can forgive us for anything. Sometimes we just got to forgive ourselves, don't we? And we truly repent, it's gone. God takes it. So we need to remember that. We don't want to carry guilt and sorrow, all right? God wants us to know His forgiveness and experience the freedom that He gives us through forgiveness of sin. That's what's so powerful. So illumination brought conviction and repentance, and that it brought joy and it brought peace to them. In verse 10 it says, and Nehemiah continued, go and celebrate with a feast of rich foods and sweet drinks and share gifts of food and people who have nothing prepared. This is a sacred day before our Lord. Don't be dejected and sad, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And the Levites too quieted the people, telling them, hush, don't weep, for this is a sacred day. So the people went away to eat and drink at a festive meal, to share the gifts of food and to celebrate with great joy, because they had heard God's word and they understood it. So when that word of God was illuminated, they understood it. All right, it brought conviction and repentance, and then it went into a transformation mode, basically. Levi said, man, stop the whimpering, man. You've been forgiven. You need to take and be joyful, all right? You've been forgiven, me. You've been convicted. You repented. It's behind you now. Stop walking around with disgusted-looking faces or sad faces. Man, you have been forgiven, man. The joy, let that joy come out. Don't let the devil convict you. It's already been taken care of. And that's what the devil tries to do. In Isaiah 51:11, it says, those who have been ransomed by the Lord will return. They will enter Jerusalem singing, crowned with everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be filled with joy and with gladness. So when we return to God, especially, because sometimes we can accept Christ and God has changed our lives, and all of a sudden, man, we are on the wrong path and we are not following Him anymore. But when He brings us back and we say, God, I tried it on my own. I knew You and You blessed me and I lived for You. And then I fell away and, man, things happened and now I'm back with You. You know what? The joy you had before you turned away from Him can be restored. He can restore the joy of your salvation, of His salvation. He can restore that. He's a God of restoration. So that's what happened. That's what can happen to us. So they mourned over their sin, the Israelites. And Nehemiah just, man, don't grieve. Don't be dejected and sad. For you know what? If you walk in that state, man, you're not going to have that joy. You're not going to have your strength. How many know if you walk around depressed and dejected and you're again, it's your thoughts, right? Even though you know the Bible says that we ask for forgiveness, we are forgiven, all right? We've got to take that to heart and say, all right, I've been forgiven. We can't walk around dejected and still continuing to carry that sin. We can't fall into that trap. Because the devil wants us to. He keeps on stabbing us in the back. Man, you did that, man. You don't deserve forgiveness, man. You're not forgiven. Anybody experienced that before? It's the devil wants us to go back to where we were, even though we're not there anymore. And we're on the right path now. So don't let the devil help you or get you to stay in guilt and sorrow. Man, I'm so sorry I did that, man. I feel so guilty. No, don't stay there. It's time to celebrate what God has done. Right? There's a lot to celebrate. You're going to heaven. He's forgiven you. You got a brand new start. That should bring some joy. Again, it's not going to bring maybe happiness, because happiness is outside circumstances. Your circumstance may not change. But inside of you, you're forgiven. You have joy there. Let it come out. Live from that. Don't live out there on circumstances, because you will always, you'll be like a pinball, all right? Happy now and sad. Happy, dejected. No, wait, we got to get back into what the Word of God says and stand on the Word of God, because that's going to be the joy. That's where the joy is going to come from, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. And strength comes from the Word of God. It brings us freedom so we can walk in forgiveness. We can walk without any kind of guilt or bondage. And the Word of God inspired this man to be joyful. So let's walk in that joy. Let's walk in His Word. Let's believe His Word for what it says. We're forgiven, man. That should just bring joy to our hearts. We don't have to go to hell. Hell's a real place. We don't have to go there. We're not going there. We know Christ. We're forgiven. We're covered by the blood, the sin. That's something to be excited about and to rejoice about. So I want to encourage you in that. So I want to ask you today, what's your joy level? 1 to 10. Think about that just for a moment. What's your joy level? I don't mean happy. I'm just happy. I'm happy because I'm going to be doing this later on today. Or I'm happy because it's my birthday next week. What's your joy level? I mean, inside. What's inside? Not the outside circumstances, but what's the joy level on the inside? Do a little assessment on that. Are you really joyful? Or are you walking around dejected? And your thought life is thinking about, man, I did this, I did that, that was horrible. God can't. We don't want to walk in that. And that's where the battleground is our mind. We got to get back to the Word of God and have God speak to our hearts and stand on, you know, as we stand on His Word, He will help to restore that joy. We can't go there walking in that guilt. The Bible says the devil is accuser of the brethren. The devil never gives up. You know that? Devil never gives up. He's always going to be there to accuse you. And if you continue to process that in your mind as he accuses you, it's going to become a reality. It's going to bring depression. It's going to bring dejection. It's going to bring unhappiness, okay, or noise. It's going to just eliminate your joy. So be careful that you don't fall into the trap of, again, continuing to roll over that sin that you did, all right, or what you committed, whatever. Man, just lay it down. Just give it to him. Because as you do that, as you sincerely do that, that joy level is going to rise in your life. And we want to be a people of joy. We've got the world out there, they don't have Christ, man. They don't have any hope. You know that? We got hope. No matter what happens out there, outside circumstances, man, we can walk in joy and peace. Anybody ever say that before to you before? Man, why are you so happy all the time or so joyful all the time? I don't know. I'm just being me. Well, they're just seeing Christ in you, aren't they? That's all they're seeing. They're seeing that joy, and the world is looking for that. So we need to make sure we walk in that freedom. The truth will set us free. The truth of us being forgiven. I just love that. Illumination and conviction comes, but conviction is awesome, but it's got to come with repentance. So we got to follow through on that. And then that's going to bring the joy. It's going to bring a transformation in our lives, and it's going to bring a joy to our hearts, something deep inside that nobody can steal, no matter what happens. And we're going to be facing some dark days in the future. The Bible says that the world is going to grow darker and darker and darker. We can see that. Turn on the news. Talk to your neighbor who's yet to know Christ. Man, it's getting dark out there. You know what? The Bible says we're going to shine even brighter. And I don't know about you, but even though outside circumstances don't look all that good, I don't want to ever lose my joy. I don't ever want to lose it. And I don't want you to ever lose that, because that's what's going to help change other people's lives and transform other people's lives, is the joy we have. And we're exemplifying and showing people that you can have joy even though things are falling apart on the outside. And people are going to want that. They're going to want that joy. And Jesus came to give it to every person. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Wasn't he going to the cross? What's the joy? The joy that was set before him? Wait a minute. If I'm facing a cross, I'm not going to have a whole lot of joy. I'm certainly not going to be happy. I'm going to pull that joy out of somewhere. But for the joy that was set before, what was that joy? I believe the joy was, hey, what I'm doing, Jesus is saying, is I'm going to go to that cross and I'm going to give my life and sacrifice my life. That brings me joy, because I know I can now give everyone that joy as they accept me as their Savior, Jesus is saying. That's what brought him joy. That's why he could have joy in the midst of a horrible circumstance. Even though he was despised and he was shamed, he had joy. Devil couldn't steal that joy. Can't let the devil steal our joy. Why? It's our strength. It helps move us forward. It's what people is looking for. Psalm 51 in closing says, Purify me from my sins and I will be clean, David says. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. David lost that joy. This is in the midst of his sin with Bathsheba, I believe. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. This is the awesome verse. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. David did a horrible thing. Committed adultery, but he went right to God and said, God, I repent, horrible thing I did, but please restore my joy, the joy of your salvation that you've given me. And God can do that today. I'm going to have the men come forward. We're going to have communion at this time. And let's really have an opportunity today, take a opportunity today to really examine ourselves. No, what's in us? What's our joy level? 1 to 10, what's your joy level? Man, if it's like a 2, maybe it's time for some little introspection as far as searching ourselves and say, is there something in my life that maybe I have yet to ask for forgiveness for, that I haven't really repented of? Or is there something in my life that I really haven't forgiven myself, that I know I've been forgiven for? Let's get to that place this morning as we take communion. That we know in our hearts that we're free from all the guilt of sin. It's been taken away when we repent. Conviction, repentance, it's gone. And let's ask him today as we take communion together, oh God, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Let that be our heart's cry today. Restore to me, we need that joy. Don't let the devil steal your joy. That's a cool song. Don't let the devil steal your joy. So let's take a moment. Let's just take in as they pass out communion today. Let's examine ourselves. Let's just say, God, point out in me anything that I need to repent of, or any guilt I have, take that away and restore to me the joy of your salvation.
Unfailing grace that saves my soul. Grace, unending grace, unending grace.
God, thank you for your grace. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's always remember that because of that broken body, because of this symbol of this bread, it reminds us that healing can come. Physical, emotional, spiritual healing can come. So as we partake this bread together, if you have a physical need or emotional need, whatever that may be, let's just give it to the Lord right now and just trust him to bring healing and wholeness to you as we partake this together. Father, we thank you for this bread that symbolizes the broken body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You are our Lord, and we thank you so much that you went through all you did, that we can stand here today over 2,000 years ago and claim healing in every way. So Father, as we just take this bread together, we just pray, God, that healing will flow in this place, Lord. Healing will flow into our bodies, oh God. All because of that broken body that hung on the cross for us. So bless this as we take it together as a family, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's partake together. In the same way, he took the cup. So this is a new covenant in my blood. Drink it and do it in remembrance of me. This cup filled with symbolic juice, the symbolic of the blood of Christ, washes away everything. Nothing that we've ever done, nothing that we ever are going to do or so cannot be forgiven. And I want to again say to you today, it's time to forgive yourself. What you did, or how that you affected that relationship, it's time to forgive yourself. You were convicted. You repented from your heart. You're so sorry. You had that godly sorrow. Some of you were even on your faces because you were so sorrowful of what you did. Today it's time to forgive yourself. The past ended last night. Jesus is forgiving you because of this blood. It's time to forgive yourself. It's time to move on. Because God wants to restore the joy of the salvation he's given you. So let's partake together. Father, we thank you so much, God, for this blood, for your blood, and for this representation of the blood. We thank you that we, because of what you've done, can be forgiven of anything, no matter how bad we think it was. In fact, I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul, who was actually killing Christians. He was a horrible guy back then. And then you transformed him by the power of your Spirit. And man, you used him greatly. You didn't look on his past. You knew his future. And as we know, his future was bright because he wrote most of the New Testament. You used him greatly. And he was a killer. He was a murderer. Oh, God. How much more can you forgive us? And use us as well. So we thank you for this cup and what it represents. We thank you, Jesus, for your blood. We ask you to bless it now in the name of Jesus as we remember what you've done for us. In Jesus' name. I just want to encourage you today. I really felt as I was just sort of thinking and praying. There's some of you here that have done some bad things, some horrible things. We've all done some pretty bad things. Some probably more bad than ever. But you know what? Sin is sin. There's no greater sin than another sin. Just lay it down. I want to encourage you in that. Walk in God's freedom. Walk in his joy. Because as you do and as you leave this place, man, your life will never be the same. I can promise you that because that's what his word says. Just like the Israelites, their lives will never be the same after that transformation time with the word of God as Ezra read that word. So as you leave today, man, just continue to keep short accounts as well because you're going to mess up again. I can promise you. You do something that was contrary to God's word, just be a quick repenter, right? God, I'm sorry. And then turn from it, walk the other way, and begin a new life again. Don't get stuck because of what the accuser of the brethren is trying to do, and that's bring guilt to your life. We're not going to walk in that. So, Father, I speak blessings over your people today, Lord. Help them to walk in that freedom. Help them to walk in that joy, oh God. For the joy of the Lord, your joy is their strength, God. So bless each and every one, Father God. I just pray that every step, Lord, that they take will be in line with your word, and if they step out of that pathway, God, that they'll be quick repenters. Because, Lord, you'll be there to receive them back into your arms, Lord. And they can continue to walk in joy each and every day, Father. So again, I speak blessings over your people, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming today. We love you so much. Spend a little time with Randy, too. Love on him a little bit as well. And then again, if you got Rachel's number, give her a call and just encourage her a little bit. Let her know where she's not forgotten. And we're not going to forget you, Randy, either. All right. Love you guys so much. So you guys have a great day. And enjoy the sunshine out there. Have a cup of coffee. Bless you.
We're choosing celebration, breaking into freedom. You're the song. You're the song of our hearts. We cast aside our shadows, trust you with our sorrows. You're the song. You're the song of our hearts. We're dancing to the rhythm of your heart. We're rising from the ashes to the stars. You're the joy, 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 light in my soul. The joy, 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 making me whole though I'm broken.